It's a joy to be back home with you here at Believer's Chapel in Dallas. It's a pleasure to be reminded again of the fruitful impact of this church's ministry on my own life. So thank you for your continued service for the Lord. For our reading of Scripture this morning, will you please turn with me to Paul's first epistle to the church in Corinth. We're going to be looking at a few verses from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. As we look at these verses, I want us to think about the title of the study we're going to have today, Two Adams and Four Epochs, the Two Men Who Define History. You remember that this is the resurrection chapter. It begins at the very start with reminding us that the gospel is inextricably bound with the resurrection of Jesus from the grave. He argues, secondly, that the resurrection of the dead is a true reality taught by the Old Testament, and it also is directly connected with Christ in his resurrection, for Jesus is the first fruits of the resurrection. The full harvest is yet to come. He's the first part of the harvest of life, conquering the grave. And then he comes to the part we're reading today at verse 35, where he will speak about the resurrection body. One of the great objections that people will have is, how is it possible that a body that has died could ever live again? Doesn't that seem awfully absurd? Well, Paul is addressing this now. Please hear the reading of God's word as we begin at verse 35 in 1 Corinthians 15. But someone will ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body do they come? You foolish person, what you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And what you sow is not the body that is to be, but a bare kernel, perhaps of wheat or of some other grain. But God gives it a body as he has chosen, and to each kind of seed its own body. For not all flesh is the same, but there is one kind for humans, another for animals, another for birds, and another for fish. There are heavenly bodies and earthly bodies, but the glory of the heavenly is of one kind, and the glory of the earthly is of another. There is one glory of the sun, and another glory of the moon, and another glory of the stars, for star differs from star in glory. So is it with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. Thus it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. But it is not the spiritual that is first, but the natural, and then the spiritual. The first man was from the earth, a man of dust. The second man is from heaven. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are of the dust. And is the man of heaven, so also are those who are of heaven. Just as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the man of heaven. May God bless the reading of his word. This chapter concludes by speaking of the mystery and the victory that comes in the resurrection of Christ that gives us great boldness to serve our Lord. Let's pray together. Such a joy to be back with you all. And as you might realize, this brings back a flood of memories for me. Dr. Johnson was one of the professors that left a permanent impression on my heart and my thinking. I was recently teaching a course on Johannine theology in Jakarta, Indonesia. And of course, I had sermon notes from Believer's Chapel with me, and I had lecture notes from Dr. Johnson. You know, they're part of the refer. I said, now, how would he handle this one here, this question, or how did he approach it? So it's a great joy to be with you again and to remember the blessings of his ministry. Today, it's my joy to turn your attention to the study of what the Bible says about history. Now, I know a lot of people don't have all that much interest in history. It's like the young college student who told his advisor, "I don't want to study history, there's no future in it." And as a historian, there's more truth in that than I hope to tell you. But as we think about history, we realize history is a field where different presuppositions, different ideologies, different prejudices show up. One of the phrases that historians often think about is, the living can make the dead do any tricks that they find necessary. See, the dead people can't fight back. So you can say, well, they actually believe this instead of that, or they did this instead of that. And how do you know? And you got to say, well, wait a second. You got to retell the story. You got to have facts. But with all the lack of interest by many for history, in spite of the prejudices that penetrate it, we need to realize that history is a serious matter. It has been said that those who don't learn from history are condemned to repeat it. Another has said, those who control the past control the future. The narrative that you are given to say where you come from determines what seems normal today and what trajectory we may be traveling. So as we wrestle with history, there are a couple reasons. Would you at least be a historian for the sermon? Okay, let me try to urge it that way. I'll give you two penetrating arguments. One is, the Bible is a book of history. Have you forgotten that is the history of salvation? It's the history of redemption. When God gave us the scriptures, he didn't give us a systematic theology. We say, I'm going to turn to the doctrine of justification by faith, or I'm going to turn to the doctrine of ecclesiology. Now, there are dramatic stories that tell us about God and his relationship with us. But then it has other forms of literature, like epistles and prophecies and poetry and apocalyptic literature, and you're familiar with the different genres of scripture. And so as we wrestle with it, we realize we have to pay attention to history if we're Bible students. We have to go back and say, well, what happened in ancient Israel? And then we say, how does that translate to where we are today in our culture? The preacher is always living between an ancient civilization and its message and the current moment in time in which he lives. The job of a minister is to take us to the past and show us the timeless truths that God has vouchsafed for the church are still relevant for us at this moment. So we need to be historically inclined. And then a second reason, 2017, does anybody remember what happened 500 years ago this year? Remember on October 31st, not Halloween Day? It was the day when Martin Luther nailed the 95 Theses on indulgences to the church door in the little town of Wittenberg where he was a professor. In that act of questioning whether you could buy the forgiveness of sins, a very lucrative business, by the way, he changed history. And if you call yourself a Protestant or part of the Protestant tradition, maybe you've been part of a Lutheran church, or you say, I'm reformational, you are connected. That's partially your birthday. And so this is a big anniversary year. It would be a great year to go and read the 95 Theses if you've never read them before. You can get them online. They're easy enough. Just go Luther 95 Theses and read them. The very first one says this. When our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ said, repent, he did not say, do penance. Now, what he was doing was actually looking at the biblical text from the Greek Bible that Erasmus had just published the year beforehand. And he says, repentance and penance, this sacrament that was part of the medieval church, were two different things. And the Bible was beginning to check a very important part of Catholicism and saying, we don't find it in the Bible. And so the great motto of the Reformation, over time, beginning with this first act of questioning if indulgences are legitimate, if they're biblical, the great Protestant principle, the great evangelical principle, the great Reformation principle, the great Reform principle is sola scriptura. We are glad to hear what popes have to say, and we're fascinated by church tradition, and we can learn of it. But there is no three-legged stool when it comes to authority. There is only one authority, and that is the Word of God. And if I can say it boldly here, Dr. Johnson is not my authority. He was one of my teachers who led me to the authority. Pete Lillback is not your authority. He's going to be pointing you to the authority. And Westminster Seminary, that has the Westminster Confession of Faith. That confession is not my final authority. It is the Word of God, only Scripture. Do you want a good argument for that? Do you remember when the Lord Jesus, who is the living Word, who is the revelation of God, when he was being encountering with the satanic forces that wanted to trip him up as he's tempted in the wilderness, having fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, do you remember how he responds? He does not say, "Satan, get away from me. Don't you know who I am? I am the incarnate, eternal Word of God. I am the Messiah. You don't speak to me that way. Go." No, what does he say? On three occasions, he says, "It is written. It is written. It is written." The living Word showed us the utter authority in the spiritual realm for the written Word of God. That's why you had to be a historian. You got to go back and say, why does a preacher open up the Bible? And why should you say he opened the Bible but he never preached it? There's something wrong. Well, you're going back to Jesus, which Luther said, take a look what the Bible says, and let's never leave from biblical authority as we teach Christian faith and practice. So history is biblical. Church history brings us back to biblical Christianity. And we could talk about the many different ways that people have sought to define history. And for the sake of time, I'm going to bring us to a very basic principle of how Christianity has looked at history as the history of salvation. You remember that going back to Augustine, studying the Bible, and as it is unfolded through history, there is a linear view of history that runs throughout the Bible. It starts with creation. God is the source of everything that there is. He created man in his image. Human history begins with a man named Adam. And that first person of human history shapes everything that follows in human history. Today, Adam is rejected by most secular historians. There was no Adam. There was just some kind of a gradual process that brought forth something called Homo sapiens sapiens. There was no Adam. The Bible says everything started with a man who bore the image of God in creation. It goes a step further. There was an extraordinary explosion of authority that occurred when Adam decided to listen to the tempter instead of listening to the revealed Word of God. We call that the fall, man's covenant breaking, Adam's rebellion against biblical authority. He abandoned sola scriptura, or let's say, only God's Word. It was that point, it may not have been written, but spoken for another alternative perspective on reality. So Adam explains, if you will, the first two stages, the first two epochs of the history of salvation, creation and fall. And then we have this wonderful history of salvation that runs through the Bible. We can talk of it as redemption, the buying back of sinners, bringing them into the covenant of grace, bringing them back into communion with God, beginning with the very first sacrifice, and then flowing out as God begins to show his plan to have a people as his own. That story then ultimately brings us to the climax of Jesus Christ, who lived and died and rose again and ever lives to intercede for his people, one who fulfilled all of the law, all of the demand of God that no one else had fulfilled beforehand. As we're going to see in this passage, he's called the second and last Adam. There's a first Adam, and there's a second Adam. And then when history reaches its telos, when it reaches its culmination, when it reaches its final climax, there is then the age of the eschaton, the final hope, the great glory that's yet to come, glorification, the blessings of eternity. And so we can think of Christian history as four great epochs with two great Adams. The first epoch is creation. The first man is Adam. The second epoch is the fall, and it's Adam and his actions in which we all stand. And then there's the epoch of redemption with the promise of salvation with the second and last Adam that finally brings us to the fourth and final epoch of the glorification of man, saved in Christ for eternal life. As we think about this stage of history, it's not just the first Adam that's been banished from our discussion. While it's still true that we date our history by the birth of Christ, what year is it? 2017? 2017 of what? Of the coming of the kingdom of Christ. In the ancient world, you interpreted your year and time by what year you were in the reign of the king. Well, no king has ever had 2017 years before, because King Jesus is not limited to one generation. He is the eternal God who reigns forever. He is now gloriously reigning. I can still remember that moment of watching back, it shows you how old I am, when the Soviet Union still was operating. And the Politburo was on television, and I got a little news clip, and I looked behind this atheistic leader of the Soviet Republic, the USSR, and there behind him, there were four numbers. It was something like 1971 or something like that. And suddenly it struck me. The atheists still have to admit they're living in the era of Jesus Christ. 1970. I said, that's the year of Christ. It's the Anno Deo, in the year of our Lord. Well, you can't say AD anymore. It's politically incorrect. Jesus Christ is being shoved from history, just as Adam has been banished from history. And so what we are doing now is that we're trying to grope in the darkness of explaining, what is the story of human history? The epochs that these two Adams define can no longer be defined without their persons. If there's no Adam, there's no creation. If there's no Adam, there's no fall. If Christ is irrelevant, there's no redemption. If there's no Christ, there is no eternity. The great Marxist view of history is, yes, we're moving forward by thesis, antithesis, synthesis, as we struggle between economic classes or cultural forces. And finally, we're going to bring in the kingdom, the utopian dream, where the state will wither away and everyone will have everything shared equally and everybody will love each other. Well, that's just a big Christian heresy. You're trying to have the kingdom without the king. You're trying to overcome sin without redemption. And how do you know history has any direction? It goes all the time. We've been hearing it in the political debates. Are you on the right side of history? The question is, how do you know where history is going if you don't have Adam and the second Adam? You don't know what's going on. You have no way to interpret reality. And so it's important as we come to this text that we keep in mind the fact that we need to have this big picture of redemptive history in our minds. And Paul is going to explain to us how these two Adams come together to explain history. Now, if you can keep that four epoch grid and the two Adams in mind, let's add one other dimension. The first Adam is creation. The fall, that's still the first Adam. But then when you come to the third epoch of salvation, that's the second Adam. And then the fourth era of hope, of glorification, that's the culmination of the work of the second Adam. Okay? Now, in the Bible, it's interesting, these four epochs are compared. The fall and redemption are compared side by side in the great passage of Romans chapter 5. Remember that? Adam sinned and he died. All that stand in Adam sin and sinned in him, and they died in him and die in history. But there's the second Adam. Christ has come. Where Adam failed, he obeyed. Where Adam brought death, he brings life. Where Adam bore the punishment and brought punishment on everyone, the second Adam bore that punishment so that others would not be punished. The fall is addressed by redemption. The two atoms side by side. But now in the passage we're about to read, we're going to discover that the two atoms are compared again. But this time it's not the fall and redemption as in Romans 5, but it's going to be the comparison of creation and our hope, the beginning and the ending, the start of all things in the first Adam in paradise with the eternal paradise that's yet to come. So we're going to talk about sinless Adam and the one who is raised to bring in eternity. Another Adam-Christ parallel. Now, why do I give you all this backdrop? Well, one, I like long introductions. I like long conclusions, too. So, see, I'm already preaching my sermon, my introduction. No, what you need to see is that you can't make sense of this passage unless you have this sweep of history in your mind. And that history is being taken away from us by a culture that doesn't talk about the first or second Adam. We have to remember these things. We must be committed to them if we're going to make sense of the Word of God. Now, as we were reading 1 Corinthians 15, you remember this is the resurrection chapter. It begins by making it clear that the resurrection of Jesus Christ is absolutely essential to the gospel. Notice what he says in verse 3 of 1 Corinthians 15. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. And then he goes on to describe all the post-resurrection appearances that ground this story in real, empirical, and verifiable history. The resurrection is part of the gospel. When you share the gospel, do you only talk about the cross? Paul says, if Christ be not raised, we are of all men most miserable. The cross is the atonement, but the resurrection is the vindication of his atonement, demonstrating that what he accomplished has efficacy. He lives. He's brought a new life. He's brought righteousness, and he brings righteousness and life to all that trust in him. Further in this passage, when he comes to verses 12 through 34, Paul takes on the next step. The Greek audience in Corinth, they were like, okay, we know this death and resurrection of Jesus. I guess we believe this. But the resurrection of the dead, wow, how can we believe that? Well, this is part of the Old Testament. Daniel and Ezekiel, and Jesus will even argue it. You remember from in the Passion Week, by the name, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He's the God of the living, not of the dead. He finds implicit in the very name of the patriarchs the resurrection life. The Sadducees who denied the resurrection marveled at his understanding of Scripture. But what we see here is that he says, now even the rituals of Israel, they were showing us the truth of resurrection. So the principle of the first fruits. When a harvester went out and gathered the first part of the harvest, he was sacrificing that which he was hungry for. He'd waited a whole year to have food, and he was giving it away to God. It was a promise, believing that there was more to come. The first fruits given to God, more to come. It was a saying that the harvest has two stages, the first, and then when it all comes in. And Paul says that's the general resurrection. Jesus is the first fruits, and the general resurrection is the full harvest. He said, if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Jesus Christ didn't rise from the dead. They are inseparably connected, one and the other. They go together. All right. Now we come to our passage, and here we discover a very powerful text where Paul is going to argue that what seems to be absurd is absolutely true, that a dead body buried in the ground, undergoing the decomposition and forces that make life utterly unthinkable, is going to live. Calvin, in his commentary, puts it this way. Listen to the blunt words he uses. There's nothing that is more at variance with human reason than this article of faith on the resurrection body, the body that rises from the dead. For who but God alone could persuade us that bodies which are now liable to corruption will, after having rotted away, or after they've been consumed by fire, or torn in pieces by wild beasts, will not merely be restored entire, but in a greatly better condition. Do not all our apprehensions of things straightway reject this as a thing fabulous, nay, most absurd? Calvin says, this is an absurd doctrine. We can't believe this. How can we reason this? Reason cannot tell us this. But now Paul is going to take it on. With what kind of body are we going to have? Listen to his argument as we start following him at verse 35. He will say, but someone will ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body do they come? In verse 36, he says, you foolish person. Do you know the Greek is absolutely blunt? It doesn't say you foolish person. This is softened for English readers. The word is fool. He punches you right in the nose that you'd ask a question in unbelief about what God can do. He just punched you in the nose. Whoever this hypothetical person and who's objecting, he says, fool, what you sow does not come to life unless it dies. Now remember, he's already talked about the harvest, planting of seed. This is something that is a normal part of all human history. In fact, the planting of seed was part of what God did in creation. Seeds fell to the ground and died, decomposed, and out of that process came forth life, even before sin was in the world. From the very beginning of human history, there is the process of the seed falling to the ground and creating new life as it has decomposed and then something new comes up. He says, do you realize that this is the principle, that sowing of seed requires death and new life? He says, and what you sow is not the body that is to be, but a bare kernel, perhaps of wheat or of some other grain. Unless you are an extraordinary horticulturist, if I have a handful of mixed seeds, you look at it and say, I have no idea what those are. They're seeds, but who knows what they're going to grow? They're whatever. It could be wheat. It could be some other kind of plant. And he says, you need to realize these seeds, when they go in the ground, they look like one thing when they go in. When they grow, they're entirely different, far greater. In fact, the seed of a giant redwood is very, very small. It creates that giant tree that goes hundreds of feet up into the heavens. Entirely different. And yet it was always implicitly present in that little seed. Paul says, don't you realize that right from the creation of everything, there was the principle of new life coming from death. And that new life from death had a diversity. Everything isn't the same. That what dies and what rises are utterly distinct. The picture is human beings. They're going to rise. And when they come out, they're not going to be what was buried. But it's going to be just as much organically connected as the seed and the plant. He says in verse 38, but God gives it a body as he has chosen, and to each kind of seed its own body. This is God's creative purpose. It's what he designed the world to be when he created the plants of the field and said, it's very good. This death and resurrection cycle is grounded in creation. Fascinating. And then he says, now, I've been talking about botany. Let's go to zoology. Okay, well, how about the animal world? He says, for not all flesh is the same, but there's one kind for humans, another for animals, another for birds, and another for fish. He's saying, take a look at your Thanksgiving dinner table, and you'll see there's fish there, and that's turkey, that's ham, that's filet mignon right there. You know, that's going to be really good. And if you're really hungry, you might have some of all of it. You know, flesh is different. Different animals, people, we're all different. And so he's saying, you realize God has put diversity in the world right from the beginning. That is, there's something different that's likely to come from what's planted and what's raised from what he first put there. So botany and zoology, but then he goes from that to astrophysics. See, Paul was quite an educated man here. He says in verse 40, there are heavenly bodies and earthly bodies, but the glory of the heavenly is of one kind and the glory of the earthly is of another. There is one glory of the sun, and another glory of the moon, and another glory of the stars, for star differs from star in glory. He says we all take it for granted that you can't look at the sun. Its glory is so great it will blind you. But the gentle hues of the moon, well, you can stare at it for hours. And then you look at the stars, and you see some are brighter as they twinkle, and others are dimmer. And some are just blurred together in the Milky Way up there and the glory that's in heaven. All glory, but there's differing glories. And so Paul is saying, there's a glory of our human life. There's beauty, there's strength, there's prowess, there's skills. But you know what? There's a far greater glory. Just like there's different kinds of flesh, there's going to be a resurrection of the body, far different. In fact, just as there's different seeds that requires death and new life, that's what's going to happen. This is God's plan. It's been true from the beginning. Botany, zoology, astrophysics, it all is showing us of God's great design. The creation is pointing us to culmination. It's pointing us from the very beginning to the glorification. We could say it that protology already possesses eschatology. Now, when you take notes, make sure you write down protology and not proctology. Do you know the difference between the two? That C makes a world of difference. It does have something to do with the beginning and the ending, but very different than what we're talking about here. I'll let you figure that out if you want to study anatomy or medicine. But what we need to see here is the beginning and the ending are already implicit in each other. Even before there is fall and redemption, God already has his plan bound up organically. Paul says resurrection was always there, if you have eyes to see. The diversity of one body to another, the greater glory from a lesser glory, the process of dying and new difference coming forth, it's all there. And then he goes on to say in verse 42, so is it with the resurrection of the dead. What I'm just describing, this is how this great eschatological hope, the fourth epoch of human history, is going to work out. It's going to be exactly the same. How does this work? Well, what is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable. You know, there's a shelf life for foods in your pantry, right? Do you ever have to go through that ritual saying, oh my goodness, this bottle of pickles has been on our shelf for 5 years. We better not open this thing up. Got to throw that out. It's perishable. Milk has a shelf life of a week or two at most in the refrigerator, and a couple days if it's left out. We're perishable. We have a shelf life if we're really very, very strong, maybe 100 if you're special. But the new life is imperishable. It will not perish. He makes another contrast. He says, it is sown in dishonor. We think of the idea of a burial. You know, a minister gets to go to a lot of funerals. And I've done many funerals through the years. And every once in a while, I stand next to the casket, and sometimes I watch it go all the way down. You know, 6 feet under is really deep when you look down there. There's nothing glorious about that. Whatever funeral process we do, whatever tombstone, we don't want that body around us. We got to get as far away from us as we can get. Because it does not have honor. You know, they tried to actually keep Mao Zedong on display in Beijing. If you go to the Great Hall of the People there in Tiananmen Square, when I was there, it was closed. I said, oh, I wanted to see Mao's embalmed body. They said, well, they were repairing it because his ear had fallen off. You see, that's not very glorious, is it? The great hero of China lost his ear as he's laying in state. Not too fancy. It is sown in dishonor. The most you do to dress it up, it's a dead body. That's who we are. But it is raised in glory. We think of Jesus as his clothes shining in majesty. We see his glory in the book of Revelation, where the eyes are blinded by the beauty of who he is. It is sown in weakness. There is nothing weaker than a dead body. You take the strongest linebacker on any NFL team, and I can whoop him any day if he's dead on the slab. He's weak. Death is weakness. But it is raised in power. There is something extraordinary that's yet to come. The strong man of this earth has not seen strength until the resurrection body is given. We don't know what that strength will be, but it's something extraordinary. Just as different as the plant in its full maturity and the seed that went in the ground. Power is that much greater. It is sown a natural body. It's just material. But it's raised a spiritual body. There's something spiritual, the power of God. God breathed into the dust of the ground and made the first Adam. When he breathes resurrection life, he makes the eternal spiritual body that is designed for eternity, that will not perish. And so we find, as he's describing these contrasts of the seed that's planted, the human body, and the great glory that is to come, he then says, I want to go back to the scriptures. So he goes back to the story of the creation of the first Adam in verse 45. He says, thus it is written, just as Jesus did with Satan, it is written. He says, okay, let's go look and see what's written. Let's go back to the scriptures. He goes to the Genesis account and he says, the first man, Adam, became a living being. God breathed into his nostrils the breath of life and he began to live. And by giving him the breath of life, he did not have self-sufficient life. He still had to eat. He had to drink. Had to stay warm. He had to exercise. He was weak, but he had life. God gave him life, just like the rest of us. But notice now we have the introduction of the words, the first man, Adam, and the last Adam. The last Adam became not a living being, but a life-giving spirit. The Lord Jesus Christ in his resurrection was not like Adam, who had the breath of life breathed into him. When he was raised, he had the power to breathe life into everyone else, even as God had breathed into the first Adam. He is one who is the life-giving risen Christ through the power of the Spirit. And so we see the last Adam is far greater than the first Adam. Now, when you think about the first and the last, what is that suggesting? Even in the names, this one who's now coming in salvation and finally for the great glorification and hope, he's the last Adam. Do you know what that means? There's nobody after him that matters. And so we have to say boldly to our Muslim friends, Muhammad cannot be the final prophet. The last Adam alone has that position. No one can come after him. He culminates the history of redemption. The last Adam. He's the one that gives us this great picture of the imperishable, of glory, of power, of a spiritual body, because he gives us of his life-giving spirit. Then he says in the next verse, verse 46, but it is not the spiritual that is first, but the natural, and then the spiritual. He's saying you need to realize that God had a plan right from the beginning, but it goes through the history of the natural order to get to the supernatural. We can never reverse the order. Adam is first, and the last Adam is second. And to explain this further, in verse 47, he says, the first man was from the earth, a man of dust. The second man is from heaven. At the end of this section, verse 49, we can call it the man of heaven. A man of dust, a man of heaven. When I was meditating on this passage, preparing it to share with you, it was in the Christmas season. I was wrestling with this passage. And it was just about the time right after Thanksgiving where I'd seen the different kind of flesh, you know, the fish and the turkey and the ham and the filet mignon on the table. And my wife said, okay, you know what comes after Thanksgiving? Christmas decorations. That meant I had to go back into the basement, way in the corner where everything's shoved away, and I had to start pulling out. And guess what I experienced? Dust is flying everywhere, blowing. reminded of that little child who came home from Sunday school and heard that man was made from the dust. He looked under his bed and he said, "Mommy, Mommy, come, come." I said, "What's wrong?" "Someone either is coming or going under my bed." We're from dust and to dust. That's who we are, right? And I had this epiphany. I said, here we are going to be celebrating Christmas, and the whole world will be. But most of people are going to be celebrating a dusty Christmas, a Jesus that is only a man from dust to dust. They're going to blow off the dust, and they're going to put it back in the dust, and that's all it is. It's all about earthly things, gifts that come that are going to perish, that are not strong, they're going to break, that have power for a while and they're going to run out of batteries. Even Duracell bunny batteries run out sooner or later. They're not going to last. They don't know the dustless, life-giving Christ of Christmas. This is the one that should be preached, because he's not wanting gifts. He's the life-giving Spirit. Christmas is Jesus giving us gifts that we never deserved, could earn, but he gives us that which we most need, which is the life that we have by faith in him. Well, you notice that here he's not called the first man, the first Adam and the last Adam. He's called the first man and the second man. So when you talk about the first and the last, that means there's no one after him. But if you say he's the first and the second, you know what that means? There's no one else between them. He's the second and the last. That means there's nobody in between this first Adam and the second Adam. They are the ones alone that are the pillars of human history. It is not Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, Moses, David, the prophets, or any other religious teacher, whether it's Buddha, anybody else you want. There's nobody else. It's Adam and the second Adam. It's Adam and the last Adam. All of history has four epochs, and these two men explain it all. And this passage is saying, when you understand this first Adam, right from the beginning, his saving work of resurrecting life was already implicit, so that when the glorification comes, he will transcend what the first Adam had in his perfection. This one is far greater. History is pointing to something far greater than Adam ever was. And this is the one who gives you hope. He is the one who makes sense of it all. Notice what it says. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are of the dust. We are dust to dust and ashes to ashes. Our life is short. But if we move from Adam's team, remember, all sin and die with Captain Adam. His football team, he went off sides and we all got penalized. He lost the game and we lost the game. But Captain Jesus on his team, he scored the goal and we win in him. Whose team are you on? He said, as you're in Adam, you die in dust to dust and ashes to ashes. But in the man of heaven, we are like the man of heaven. We have life in him. We have glory in him. We have power in him. We have resurrection hope in him. We have the ability to see things that are far greater than this world ever known in him, because there's a greater glory to come. Planned from the beginning, creation is nothing compared to the recreation, the glory to come. So just as we've borne the image of the man of dust, we're like Adam, sons of Adam, but we shall also bear the image of the man of heaven. The second Adam takes us from creation and brings us resurrection glory, far greater than anything else. He cancels out the power of sin and gives us something greater than even the redemption you have today. A restoration, a glory that's greater than anything we know. As we conclude and we meditate on this view of history, let's rehearse quickly what we said. Two Adams, the first and last, the first and the second. No others can explain history. Only Adam and creation and Adam and fall can explain the second Adam in redemption and the great culmination of resurrection glory that's yet to come. Are we living a life of just a dusty Christmas, a dusty life of the material things of the earth? As C.S. Lewis put it, is your life always winter and never Christmas? It's just this world. Or have you touched the eternal values that Jesus Christ brings? Which Adam do you stand in? Are you going to stand before God as a son and daughter of Adam, Well, you're headed for dust and despair, the dust of death. But if you stand in the last and second Adam, you are destined to have the life-giving spirit of the glory that transcends anything that even creation at its best ever offered. This is the glory that awaits us. So as I conclude, a few word pictures that maybe will help you to try to apply this to your life. Perhaps you remember the famous preacher George Whitefield. I just was at the George Whitefield Society in Oklahoma City. Maybe you remember the name of David Hume, the famous atheist. They were in the city of Glasgow at the same time in the 1700s. Whitefield was preaching and crowds were coming. Imagine this, at 5 a.m. in the morning. Crowds of people came to hear this extraordinary evangelist with a voice that sounded like a jet engine that would shake the building when he preached. And someone saw David Hume in the crowd and they said to him, "But Mr. Hume, I didn't think you believed." And he said, "I don't, but he does." Isn't that amazing? When this hope of the gospel resurrection grips our hearts, the unbeliever looks and says, "What's with you? What's going on?" We have tasted of the age to come. We've sensed the glory, the gospel spirit's within us. And it triumphs over the challenges of life. And it is something that cannot be pushed aside because the power of the resurrection is resting upon us. Today you might say, "I hope I can believe. I struggle to believe." But I'm reminded of the way that the great bridge was built over the cataract at Niagara Falls. Do you know how they built a bridge? Somebody started with an arrow with a string on the end, a little thread. Pow, the thread went all the way across and hit the other side. A good archer. And then they took the thread and they put a little piece of string on the end and they pulled it over. After the string got over, then they took a rope and tied it and they pulled the rope over. And after the rope got over, then they tied a piece of iron rope and they pulled it over. And once they had that over, then they connected it to pieces of steel and started pulling them over. And this is what God is calling you today. Your faith, it's so weak. I think I told her this morning about my trip from Halmahera to Moratai Island and the terror of a boat that was being smashed around by the waves. Begin to exercise this faith. And this faith begins to bring you already into the eschaton of glory. Say, "Lord, I trust you. I believe, Lord, help thou my unbelief." Today in the struggle, begin to exercise that little thread-like hope that God's Spirit is building in your heart and let it grow so that you will have what Paul describes as having received the gospel with power and deep conviction. Today you say, "I wish I could believe this. I'm so pessimistic. Nothing's going right." It's like a professor in a class at a university who said, "Life is miserable, life's absurd, and then you die. There's no reason to even live." And a student was talking, he said, "What's wrong with you today? Life is lousy, isn't it?" He said, "Yeah, my dog's so sick, as my best friend." He said, "Well, you should just put him to death. Just euthanize him, there's no reason to have a sick dog." And as he was lecturing, he was waxing eloquent about his view of hopelessness and meaningless of life. And he finally said, "Life is so miserable, I wish I were dead. There's no reason to live. What a waste of time life is. Life is absurd, it's meaningless, and there's no significance." And the student who heard that was utterly shocked. He thought about euthanizing the student's dog and about the professor who said, "Well, it might as well die." So he asked for an appointment in the professor's office. And he was granted the permission. He came in with a rifle. He said, "Sir, I'd like to put you out of your misery." Now, this was years ago before there were like microaggressions and macroaggressions and all sorts of things. Professor says, wait, I didn't mean it. He said, "I didn't think so, but I wanted to know for sure." And you know what? That is the attitude of the unbelieving world. They tell you they don't believe anything. But down deep inside, they're wondering, is there something more? There must be something more. Why does life even exist? Brothers and sisters, you have already tasted of the resurrection life in Jesus Christ. And when you begin to exercise that, as insignificant as any of us feel, we begin to be that little ray of light shining in the darkness. And they say, what is that? That's called gospel hope. And that's what you have, because you have met the second and last Adam. And by meeting him, you've already tasted something far greater than Adam ever knew. You've tasted of the resurrection power that is going to bring you to the full glory of the blossom that's beginning to be formed in you. So can I conclude simply with this? As a Christian on the team of King Jesus, the best is yet to come. Celebrate. The gospel is yours through Jesus Christ. But if you're not on his team, you're a man or woman of dust. Adam is your Savior, and he's going to save you as far as 6 feet under and what comes after that. Today is the day to believe in Jesus Christ, because he is the one who explains all of history as the second and last Adam. Father, thank you that we have the joy of meditating on your word. Thank you for the history of salvation. Thank you for the work of the gospel that is now ours. And so, Lord, I add this to my prayer as Spurgeon used it years ago to conclude a sermon he preached. Let the vain world pronounce its shame and fling their scandals on your cause. We come to boast our Savior's name and make our triumphs in his cross. With joy we tell a scoffing age, he who was dead has left the tomb. He lives above their utmost rage, and we are waiting till he come. O Lord, may we wait with expectation, with hope and certainty, that you are the second and final and absolutely triumphant Adam that gives us hope. Pray this in Christ's name. Amen. So then, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, both now and forever. Amen.